Yo, yo, Jacob Perry back with you, founder of Patagonia Bee Products. And this is episode 36 on this vlog we're doing on Patagonia, on beekeeping, on honey, on how we're doing business. And today I want to revisit something we've touched before, but in a little bit more detail. This is monofloral honey versus single origin. So that we're playing a little, doing a little play on it today because people throw around single origin a lot. Because single origin is used for chocolate and for coffee and for other things. And I want to talk about the difference in honey, in honey production. And kind of the simple answer is there's really not much of a difference between single origin and monofloral, but there can be. It's kind of vague. So in the honey industry, it's not as common to use single origin, and single origin could refer not just to the honey being from a single flower source, so that would be monofloral, right? Literally monofloral, single flower. But single origin could also mean that it's from a single place. Honey just from the rainforests of Chile, for example, or from Zambia, or from whatever, from a specific apiary somewhere. So that can be single origin. It doesn't necessarily have to be that it's from a single flower type. We could say this is a single origin honey all harvested in the rainforests of the Amazon, all right? But if you're gonna say it's a monofloral honey, that means that the majority of the nectar source, the majority of the nectar was gathered from a specific flower, and that the bees made the honey from that nectar, right? And different countries and different groups have different standards for that, right? The European Union is something like 35-40%, if I remember right, for it to be called monofloral. The United States, it just declares it has to be the majority, so you take that as you want. In Chile, it's 45. So now, all of our honeys, just a side note, all of our honeys are close to 90. A lot of them are close to 90. We've had some in the 70s before. But that's about as low as it goes. So we get very high percent monofloral honeys. So always the question we get asked is, how do you train the bees to go to specific flowers? How are you making the bees go and say, hey, you go to that flower because we need to make an ulmo honey. And then you bees over there, you go to the tineo flowers because we need that honey. Well, you can't do that, right? That's probably around the corner with all this technology. That's where it's going to take over the world. The bees are going to be smarter than us. And then they're going to sell us fake honey, right? Just like the fake news. The bees are going to sell us fake honey because we don't know any better and they're super smart. That's just the way we're going. But check it out. The way they do it is that different flowers will bloom during different times of the year, right? That's just the nature of the world, right? Some flowers bloom in the spring, some in the summer, some in the fall. And so what happens is bees, like any other animal except humans, we're kind of the exception. Bees know what food sources are good for them. Most animals do, right? They're not going and just eating poison all the time or eating things they can't digest, etc. They're pretty good about knowing what food is digestible and nutritious. Bees will go to a flower that has a richer nectar source than a poorer one, okay? And then they communicate this. They do a thing called the bee dance. So they communicate this within the hive. They're telling each other where to go. And the flower sources that are responsible for our honeys are very rich in nectar, and that's why we get monofloral honeys from those varieties. So during the specific seasons when the ulmo is in bloom, for example, in the Patagonian late summer, or the tineo in the spring, that is the primary flower in bloom that is rich in nectar, and that's what the bees are going to, and that's how you get a honey that is like 90% that flower source. And then the tineo stops blooming, the bees have to go to a new source, and whatever the new source is, if it's abundant and it's a rich nectar source, then the beekeepers can time their harvests so that their apiaries will fill back up with the honey, right, of a new type of monofloral honey. And guess what? The same apiary can harvest like 3-4 monofloral honeys in the same year because of this, if they time their harvest. Pretty cool, huh? That's some very crafty beekeeping. And it's something that is allowing us to offer you these really unique honeys instead of it just being all the bear honey. Ugh. So there you are. There's a difference. And we'll catch you on the next one. Ciao.